This is the true story of a cactus attack. The story of how the prickly pear ran rampant in Australia for decades, taking over millions of hectares. But even more interesting than that story is the story of how the cactus was controlled. One of the most successful biological control stories of all time that even many Australians don't know. And it all has to do with this understated insect. Prickly pears were introduced to Australia in the 1700s. The idea was to start cultivating cochineal insects, which live on the cacti and feed on them. These insects, when crushed, form the basis of a nice red dye, which you might have seen on food packaging as carminic acid, cochineal, or 120. Throughout the next century, into the 1800s, more cactus species were introduced in several waves. This includes lots of prickly pears, which are part of the Opuntia genus. Obviously, introducing new species doesn't always go as planned. Beyond the intentional replanting of cacti for cochineal insects and for fencing, Opuntia started to spread on its own. It did this in two main ways. The prickly pears of the prickly pear cactus are delicious, so Australia's wildlife, in particular birds, started munching on the fruits and spreading the seeds. This is a pretty simple mechanism. The bird eats the fruit with its mouth, the seed travels through as the bird flies or walks a distance away from the original plant, and the seed is deposited onto the ground via the cloaca. But the more insidious spread came from the pads of the cacti themselves. See, Opuntia pads, which are technically called cladodes, can regrow into a whole new plant if broken off. Once on the ground, they grow roots of their own and form a new plant. Farmers trying to slash the cacti soon found that the cladodes left on the ground began to reanimate and regrow. Not to mention a particularly nasty flood in 1893 that damaged lots of cacti and spread their fallen limbs far and wide to regrow where they washed up. The prickly pear didn't take over all at once, but once they do take hold, cacti, it turns out, are somewhat prickly customers. By the early 1920s, the prickly pear had taken over swathes of farmland in Queensland and New South Wales. It was completely dominating some parts of the land, leaving it unable to be used. At its peak, Opuntia took up an area of land in Australia similar to the size of the entirety of the island of Great Britain. That's about 250,000 square kilometres. So we have a plant that's super hard to get rid of because of its naturally defensive cactus spines and its innate ability to regenerate from its amputated limbs, and has Australian animals in its thrall to spread its seeds via delicious fruits, that is dominating an area about the size of Oregon. So Australia needed to do something. They tried slashing, burning, and poisoning, but all of these methods were either incredibly labour-intensive, thanks to the dense growth of cactus adorned with thorns, or had little effect on the cactus, thanks to its ability to regenerate, or were expensive, or were bad for livestock, or all of the above. To further investigate other means of cactus control, the Prickly Pear Travelling Commission was formed in 1912, followed by the Commonwealth Prickly Pear Board in 1919. Researchers travelled to native cactus habitats in the Americas, where they hoped to find a solution. The idea was that the cactus had become a pest in Australia because of the lack of natural adversaries. In their native habitats, prickly pears have to contend with all kinds of diseases, insects, fungi that didn't exist in Australia. So the researchers brought back many different kinds of insects to experiment on controlling the cactus. The cochineals, they found, were pretty good at eating cacti, in particular the tree pear species. But the real heroes were drab, brown moths and their brilliant orange larvae, Cactoblastis cactorum. Just as a quick reminder, moths and butterflies start life as caterpillars, which are larvae, which form pupae, which become moths, which lay eggs, which hatch larvae. So before I show you some of the most amazing before and after photos you've probably ever seen, let's find out how Cactoblastis cactorum was so successful. Basically, they did this.
The larvae of the Cactoblastis moth are voracious, and they burrow into the cladodes of the prickly pear and eat it from the inside. Then, when they're nice and fat, they form pupae, undergo metamorphosis, become moths, fly off to a new cactus, lay eggs in an egg stick that looks like a cactus spine. The eggs hatch to release more larvae which burrow into the fresh cactus, and the cycle continues. Once scientists realised how successful the moths could be, they started breeding it en masse in research stations.
From there, they distributed around 3 billion eggs to cactus-infested areas between 1926 and 1930, including supplying farmers with Cactoblastis eggs free of charge.
Within the next decade, even within the next 5 years, the cactus population had been obliterated. The mechanism by which the moths can find new cacti is actually really cool and has to do with the cacti's own adaptation to arid environments. I'll link a good video that describes how cacti do photosynthesis in more detail, but if you want a super simple summary, plants have pores in their leaves called stomata through which they suck in carbon dioxide in order to strip the carbon to use it to build sugar to store energy.
They do this by using much smaller bite-sized packets of energy, which they make using the energy from light. This whole process is called photosynthesis, and Kurzgesagt recently made a nice video on these tiny energy packets, which I'm sure many of you have seen, but if you haven't, you should check it out.
Having your pores open all day causes you to lose some moisture to the atmosphere, and that is particularly true if you're in a dry climate. So cacti and other plants have evolved a clever way of reducing their water loss. It's called CAM photosynthesis. Basically, they open their pores when it's cool, like at night, to suck in carbon dioxide.
Remember, photosynthesis needs light, so when the stomata are open at night, when there is no light, they store the carbon for later use.
During the day, the pores are closed to stop evaporation and moisture loss, but that's okay because the stored carbon is then used for photosynthesis with the daylight. That is a very long way of saying that the Cactoblastis moths can sense carbon dioxide gradients. So when the cacti are sucking in CO2 at night, they're creating a relative sink, which, along with other compounds, the moths use to locate them.
So back to our voracious larvae. The cacti which have been eaten from the inside finally die.
This was unbelievably successful in terms of controlling the overgrowth of prickly pear in Australia. Land that had been completely overrun was cleared. Farms that were abandoned were usable again. This turned out to be one of the greatest ever biological control stories in history. And aside for how industrious the distribution of eggs was, there was one defining reason which made it so successful. The moths only like eating cactus. All insect species were tested rigorously before being released. And unlike other introduced species, they weren't interested in other sources of food that Australia had to offer, so they didn't wreak environmental chaos of their own. But instead, they reached an equilibrium. That means that once the cactus population had been reduced so much that it couldn't sustain a large moth population, the excess moths just died. They didn't go off and ruin native species. There are still areas of wild prickly pear in Australia, and there is still Cactoblastis feasting on it.
There is one more thing to say before closing out this story.
Cactoblastis was a huge success in Australia, even garnering tributes from several memorials, which you should visit in the towns of Chinchilla, Benaga, and Dalby if you're ever in Queensland. But in the US, the Cactoblastis moth is more of a villain. Since being introduced via the Caribbean, there are fears that the Cactoblastis is endangering native cactus species across the southern US and could endanger Opuntia in Mexico as well.
One region's unprecedentedly successful biological pest control is another region's threat to the delicate cactaceae species in their own habitat. Thanks for watching. I hope you at least enjoyed it and at most learned something. I'll see you next time.